You are listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's readings, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ our Lord and Savior. We ask this in the name of the Most Holy Lamb of God, through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 45. In this episode, we'll continue reading from Volume 1, from the section related to the Most Holy Incarnation. Today, we'll read chapters 19 and 20. 19. The Death of Holy Simeon. I saw that Simeon, after prophesying in the temple, returned home and fell sick. I saw him on his couch giving his last advice to his wife and sons and imparting to them his joy. Then I saw him die. There were several old Jews and priests praying around him. When he had breathed his last, they carried the body into another room where, without stripping it, it was washed. The body was laid on a board pierced with holes, under which was a copper basin to receive the water as it fell. A large sheet was thrown over the corpse, and under that the washing was performed. Green leaves and herbs were then strewn plentifully over it, and a wide cloth bound firmly around it, as is done in the swathing of a child. The corpse was so stiff and straight that I was tempted to think it was bound to a board. The burial took place in the evening. Six men with lights carried the corpse on a board with low, curved sides to the sepulchre hewn in a hill not far from the temple. It was entered through an oblique door. The interior walls were ornamented with stars and various figures like the Blessed Virgin's cell at the temple. I noticed the same kind of ornamentation in St. Benedict's first cloister. The corpse was deposited in the center of the little cave, the passage around it being left free. Then some religious rites were solemnized. They laid all kinds of things around the corpse, coins and little stones and leaves. I think I do not now remember all distinctly. Simeon was related to Veronica, and through his father with Zachary also. His sons served in the temple and were also, though in secret, on terms of friendship with Jesus and his relatives. Some of them before and some after the ascension of our Lord joined the disciples at the time of the first persecution. They did much for the community. Quotation or footnote one, that community, the early Christians. 20, return of the Holy Family to Nazareth. I saw the Holy Family returning to Nazareth by a much more direct route than that by which they had gone to Bethlehem. On their first journey, they had shunned the inhabited districts and seldom put up at an inn. But now they took the straight route, which was much shorter. Joseph had in his cloak pocket some little rolls of thin, yellow, shining leaves on which were letters. He had received them from the Holy Kings. The shekels of Judas were thicker and in the form of a tongue. I saw the Holy Family arrive at Anne's in Nazareth. The eldest sister of Mary, Mary Healy, with her daughter Mary Cleophas, a woman from Elizabeth's place, and that one of Anne's maids who had been with Mary in Bethlehem were there. A feast was held, such as had been celebrated at the departure of the child Mary for the temple. Lamps burned above the table, and there were some old priests present. Things went on quietly, though there was great joy over the child Jesus, yet it was a calm inward joy. I have never seen much excitement among those holy souls. They partook of a slight repast, the women, as usual, eating apart from the men. I can remember no more of this vision, although I must have been present in a very real way, for I had to accomplish in it a work of prayer. In Anne's garden, notwithstanding the season, I saw the number of pears, plums, and other fruits still on the trees, although the leaves had already fallen. I had always forgotten to say a word about the weather in Palestine during the winter season, because being so accustomed to it, I think that everyone else knows it too. I often see rain and fog and sometimes snow, but it soon melts away, and I see many trees upon which fruit is still hanging. There are, in the year, several harvests, the first in what corresponds to our spring. In the present season, winter, I see the people on the roads wrapped up in mantles, which are thrown over the head also. On the sacred night of Christmas, I always see everything green, blossoming, and full of flowers, the animals frolicsome, the vineyards laden with luscious grapes, and I hear the sweet caroling of birds. But immediately after, it is again quiet and just as it usually is there at this season. The tree outside of Bethlehem and under which Mary stood while Joseph was seeking an inn was, as long as she remained under it, quite green. It afforded ample shelter, but when she left it, it resumed its wintry nakedness. This was perhaps only a mark of reverence, but the Blessed Virgin was fully conscious of it. The shepherd field was, however, already green at this season, for they watered it. The road from Anne's house to Joseph's in Nazareth was about 1.5 hours' distance and ran between gardens and hills. I saw Joseph at Anne's loading two asses with many different things and going on before with Anne's maid to Nazareth. Mary followed with Anne, who carried the child Jesus. Mary and Joseph had no care of the housekeeping. They were provided with all things by Anne, who often went to see them. I saw her maid carrying provisions to them in two baskets, one on her head, the other in her hand. I saw the Blessed Virgin knitting or crocheting little robes. To her right side was fastened a ball of wool, and she had in her hands two short needles of bone, I think with little hooks at the end. One was about 1/2 ell long, the other shorter. The stitches were arranged on the needles above the hooks, over which, in doing the work, the thread was thrown and the stitch thus formed. The finished web hung between the two needles. I saw Mary thus working, either standing or sitting by the child Jesus, who lay in his little basket cradle. I saw St. Joseph out of the long strips of bark, yellow, brown, and green, plaiting screens, large surfaces, and covers for ceilings. He had a stock of this woven board-like work piled under a shed near the house. He wove into them all kinds of patterns, stars, hearts, etc. I thought as I looked at them that he had no idea how soon he would have to leave all. I saw the Holy Family while at Nazareth, visited also by Mary Healy. She came with St. Anne, bringing with her her grandson, a boy of about 4 years, the child of her daughter Mary Cleophas. I saw the holy women sitting together, caressing the child Jesus and laying it in the little boy's arms. They acted just as people do nowadays. Mary Healy lived in a little town about 3 hours east of Nazareth. She had a house almost as large as her mother's. It had a courtyard surrounded by a wall and in it a well with a pump. On pressing with the foot at the base of the pump, the water flowed out into a stone basin before it. Mary Healy's husband was named Cleophas. Their daughter, Mary Cleophas, who had married Alpheus, lived at the other end of the town. That evening, I saw the holy women praying together. They were standing in front of a little table, which fastened to the wall and covered with red and white. On it lay a roll, which Mary unfolded and hung up on the wall. A figure was embroidered on it in pale colors. It was like a corpse, entirely enveloped in a long white mantle. It had something in its arms. I saw a picture like it at Anne's during the festival before Mary's departure for her presentation in the temple. A lamp was burning during their prayer. Mary stood a little in front of the table with Anne and Mary Healy on either side. At certain times, they crossed their hands upon their breast, folded them together, or stretched them forth. Mary read out of a roll that lay before her. They prayed in measured and steady tones. It reminded me of choir chanting. This concludes our reading today for this section that we've been focusing on today, the death of Holy Simeon and the return of the Holy Family to Nazareth. And now we begin our reflection on what we've listened to. We heard about the death of Holy Simeon, and he returned home, fell sick. So this is the fulfillment of what God is doing for him. I saw him on his couch giving his last advice to his wife and sons, imparting to them his joy. And so you kind of place yourself there and, well, what is Simeon telling them? Maybe he's giving them something to look forward to. Be sure to follow this Jesus that I just saw in the temple. Maybe that's the wisdom. All these people praying around him. And then we heard that he was buried and made me wonder, do people visit the tomb of Simeon? I've been to the Holy Land twice, and I can't say I have a recollection of going to the tomb where Simeon, this priest of the temple, where he was buried. Is it a place still of veneration today? That's a question I ask from all of this. And then we get into the return of the Holy Family to Nazareth. And just the experience that they are having as they return. Just, a few things. The tree outside of Bethlehem, under which Mary stood while Joseph was seeking an inn, was, as long as she remained under it, quite green. It afforded ample shelter, but when she left it, it resumed its wintry nakedness. What a bizarre fact, circumstance of nature, but what's it telling us? It tells us that Mary is the mother of life. She's the mother of Jesus, who is the life giver for all of us. And even all of creation recognizes Mary as this mother of life. And Mary, who is restoring creation because of the fall and by giving birth to the Redeemer, that where there is death, she has brought life. And where this tree is naked, it's full when she is there. Interesting nature responding to Our Lady. I saw the Blessed Virgin knitting or crocheting little robes. Think about Mary preparing the garments for Joseph or for Jesus. She saw Saint Joseph. But most moving, that evening I saw the holy women praying together. The lamp was burning. They were praying with folded hands. The women together praying. How beautiful. God has called them together as family. And with Jesus present among them, they are praying to the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. How important prayer is. And for us to join in prayer as a community with people around us. Lifting our voices together in praise to the Lord God. And again, as Mary is there praying with others, I can only imagine that she's giving her Magnificat once again. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. This brings us to an end of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com. And use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. Also, please share the podcast with others. Email it to your friends, text a link, invite them to begin listening so that you can have holy conversations with your family and friends about the writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich. Don't forget to rate and review the podcast on whatever platform you're listening. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelation with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you and Mary pray for you.